and FBI documents later proved a politically motivated attempt to deport Lennon. On October 7, 1975, the court finally overturned John's deportation order. John was free to stay in America permanently. 2 days later, on John's 35th birthday, after three miscarriages, Yoko gave birth to Sean Ono Lennon. In 1971, John and Yoko left England for New York City. New York City. New York City. Excited by the high energy level of the city, they lent their support to left-wing activists like Jerry Rubin and Abby Hoffman. The subjects of John and Yoko's political songwriting became more specific. On Sometime in New York City, they sang about the Attica prison riots, feminism, and Angela Davis.
Apathy, isn't it? And that we can do something. Okay, so flower power didn't work, so what? We start again. This song I wrote for John Sinclair.
It ain't fair, John Sinclair, in the staff of breathing air.
In December 1971, John and Yoko played a benefit for the radical activist John Sinclair, who was sentenced to 10 years in jail for selling two joints to an undercover narcotics agent.
They gave him 10 for two. What else can Judge Columba do? We got to.
2 days after the concert, Sinclair was released.
Got to set him free. Free!
Welcome to the Mike Douglas Show. This is John Lennon.
And Yoko Ono.
We're Mike's co-host this week.
In 1972, John and Yoko agreed to co-host the mainstream Mike Douglas Show for a week.
What would you like to talk about this week, John?
Well, we like to talk about love, peace, communication, women's lib.
Racism.
And
about
war,
prison conditions.
Prisons.
And drugs.
Life in general.
Drugs.
John and Yoko invited activist guests like Bobby Seale and Jerry Rubin.
Nationalism, or nationhood, you know, always hooked up, is akin to superiority, is akin to racism, is akin to
sectarianism. That's what I said in my song.
Introducing radicals and Black Panthers to Middle America turned out to be John and Yoko's most genuinely subversive act.
Just think everybody should register to vote, because that's power if we all vote together. And we shouldn't vote for any candidate that doesn't automatically withdraw everything from Vietnam. And we ought to go to both conventions in Miami and San Diego and nonviolently make our presence felt and stand on the issues.
Richard Nixon's White House feared John's political influence and was upset by rumors that he would try to disrupt the 1972 Republican convention in Miami with a free concert. To keep John from stirring up trouble, the Justice Department secretly planned to have Lennon deported to Britain, using his old British drug arrest as an excuse. John Lennon, crusader for peace, had aroused the animosity of the White House, Attorney General, and FBI. His life was about to be turned upside down.
I was privileged to be part of one of the world's great hoaxes. I buried Paul. I was a disc jockey. I picked up the phone and the kid said, "Have you ever played on the White Album, number 9, backwards?" It says, "Turn me on, dead man." The minute that thing went off the air, and people were calling me from all over the world, we wondered, what the hell are we on to? Do you think he's really dead?
He's alive and well. And Wednesday, Paul McCartney's getting into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame with Billy Joel, Bruce Springsteen, and more. It's Rock's Biggest Night, Wednesday at 9, 8 Central, and it's only on VH1.
All right, we're sitting here with Art Alexakis from Everclear. He will be inducting Del Shannon into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame tomorrow night, 9, 8 Central. It's the 1999 Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction ceremony and concert. Gosh, who are you excited to see perform?
I'm excited to see everyone. Bruce Springsteen is probably the closest thing to my heart. But everybody, Paul McCartney, it's just going to be a blast.
Okay, well, if you want to see it, you better tune in. We'll see you then.
In 1972, John Lennon became a target of the Nixon administration. Since arriving in New York in 1971, John and Yoko were visible members of the anti-war movement. In February 1972, South Carolina Senator Strom Thurmond received a tip that Lennon planned to perform at an anti-Nixon rally outside the Republican National Convention. Thurmond sent a memo to Attorney General John Mitchell suggesting deportation would be a strategic countermeasure. The Attorney General passed Thurmond's memo to the Immigration and Naturalization Service. On March 6th, the INS revoked John Lennon's visa and began deportation hearings based on his 1968 cannabis conviction.
Do you think that you will be deported?
I have no idea. Maybe it's just a process. I don't know.
I was scared, paranoid. When it first started, I was followed in a car, and my phone was tapped.
In early 1973, he was ordered out of the country within 60 days. John began a counterattack, launching a campaign to obtain a green card, which would allow him to remain in the country. To complicate matters, Yoko had become locked in a bitter dispute with her first husband, Anthony Cox, over the custody of their daughter, Kyoko. When Yoko won custody, Cox took the girl and disappeared. Distraught, the Lennons hired a private detective to locate the girl, but came up empty.
We're not allowed to see our daughter, and Yoko's going mad, as any mother would, because her daughter's been withheld from her. That's all we have to say about that.
The stakes were high. If John and Yoko left the country, she would lose all legal claims to Kyoko. If she stayed and John was deported, she would lose him. In effect, she was being forced to choose between her husband and her child. The pressure of the situation took its toll on John and Yoko's marriage. John was becoming increasingly difficult to live with, and at Yoko's insistence, in October 1973, they separated.
The pressure on us was too hard. For me, it was. It was getting to a point where my identity was totally lost. Not totally lost, but I felt like it was getting to be lost, you know. So it was kind of important for me to have my own space, in a way, for a while. That was so definitely important.
Nobody loves you when you're down and out. Nobody knows you when you're on cloud nine.
Yoko remained in New York at their apartment in the Dakota, and John went to Los Angeles, accompanied by their assistant, May Pang. Hanging out with Harry Nielsen, Keith Moon, and other pals, he lived an extended period of drunken excess, which he later referred to as his lost weekend. Lennon reached a low point one night at the Troubadour Club. He heckled the Smothers Brothers, got into a fist fight, and was thrown out of the bar. This embarrassing incident made front page headlines around the country, not the sort of publicity John needed to battle immigration authorities.
I got drunk and shouted. It was the first night I drank Brandy Alexander's, which is brandy and milk, folks. And I was with Harry Nielsen, who didn't quite get as much coverage as me. And they just sort of said, oh, okay, you better leave, Mr. Lennon. They took me out. It was a mistake, but hell, you know, I'm human.
You don't know what you've got until you lose it.
Several times during their separation, John phoned Yoko and begged to come home. She told him he wasn't ready.
I really, really needed to be with her, wanted to be with her, and could not literally survive without her as a functioning human being. I just went to pieces, and I didn't realize that I needed her so much.
In late 1974, the clouds began to part.
Whatever gets you through the night.
John had made a bet with his friend Elton John that if his single, Whatever Gets You Through the Night, went to number one, John would perform at one of Elton's shows. When the song topped the charts, John made good on his promise and joined Elton on stage at New York's Madison Square Garden. Backstage after the show, Yoko turned up. It was the first time the two had seen each other in over a year. Soon after, they were reunited for good. Lennon said later that the separation didn't work out.
The fans' reaction was very interesting, that they actually liked the fact that we came back together again, which was like, wow, is this, are we dreaming, you know? But we didn't expect that.
By 1974, the dirty tricks of the Nixon White House had been publicly exposed. Attorney General Mitchell went to jail for his role in the Watergate scandal, and FBI documents later proved a politically motivated attempt to deport Lennon. On October 7, 1975, the court finally overturned John's deportation order. John was free to stay in America permanently. 2 days later, on John's 35th birthday, after three miscarriages, Yoko gave birth to Sean Ono Lennon.
I think that our lives were really full of miracles and full of unexpected events, you know. But that was really something else. It was beautiful. That was like having, you know, like three top, well, number one records or something at the same time. It was great.
All the pieces were falling into place for John. He was free of government harassment. He was reunited with his one true love. And now they had a son and a settled family life. It was everything he'd always wanted. Pledging his undivided attention to his new son, John Lennon went home with Sean and Yoko and disappeared from the public eye. One of the most famous men in the world had decided to stay home and raise his child. The world would not hear from John Lennon again for 5 years.
They turned songs into anthems and concerts into spectacles. The world was their stage. Queen are legends.
It's so loaded, you don't eat it, you serve.
Attention. 5 years after the birth of Sean, John was ready to share his music with the world again and began recording with Yoko. John came out of his seclusion to speak excitedly with interviewers about his comeback album, Double Fantasy. After a lifetime of turmoil, John was finally happy. It'll be just like
starting over. We were probably both hiding to each other how much we're missing about working. He was gloriously happy, is how I would put it.
When I was singing and writing this and working with her, I was visualizing all the people of my age group and singing to them. Did you get through it all? Wasn't the 70s a drag, you know? Here we are, well, let's try and make the 80s good, you know? Because it's still up to us to make what we can of it. It's not out of our control. I still believe in love. Peace. I still believe in positive thinking. While there's life, there's hope. I always consider my work one piece, and I consider that my work won't be finished until I'm dead and buried, and I hope that's a long, long time.
At one point, I think that at night he was kind of crying, and I was thinking, what? And he was saying that if I ever die, you know, those are going to make it so difficult for you. I'm wondering if, on a very subconscious level, that he knew that we were going to separate, that I was going to be left alone. It's possible.
Coming home from the studio on December 8, 1980, John Lennon was shot and killed by an unstable fan.
It's really such a pity, because what happened at the time when John was really feeling very creative and inspired.
Imagine all the people living for today.
John Lennon survived a troubled childhood to achieve his wildest dreams. At the peak of his success, he walked away to live on his own terms. He found the peace and the family he had been searching for his whole life. The world we live in is a world transformed by John Lennon's music, art, and ideas. His death was a tragedy. His life was a triumph.
You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us and the world will live as one. Imagine no possessions.
You're watching VH1's Rock and Roll Hall of Fame Legends Marathon. Up next, they're rock and roll royalty. They're eligible for the Hall of Fame. They're Queen. Their story is next. And tomorrow night at 9, 8 Central, don't miss this year's Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction ceremony, only on VH1.
You may say.